notes, no blanks there, but I need to take the time to explain the implications of these 10 rules that we have here. The implications when we say we believe that the Bible is plenary verbal inspiration of the Bible. So what does plenary mean? Plenary means all. So we have a plenary session, that means everybody should be there. Nobody should be shopping. You know, everybody should come to the session. And then verbal means the very words, not just the general idea, you know, not just the general thought, but the actual words. We believe that the Holy Spirit guided these writers in even choosing the right words. Within their vocabulary, God was able to express accurately what He wants to communicate to His people. And so what are the implications of plenary verbal inspiration? Okay, number one, no blanks in your notes. Number one, plenary verbal inspiration does not teach that all parts of the Bible are equally important, but only that they are equally inspired. Okay, what does that mean? They are not equally important, but they are only equally inspired. For example, friends, Judges 3:16 is not as important as John 3:16, but they are equally inspired. Okay, we got that? Obviously, John 3:16 is more important than Judges 3:16. But it simply means they are equally inspired. Number two, plenary verbal inspiration does not guarantee the inspiration of any modern or ancient translation of the Bible, but deals only with the original Hebrew and Greek languages. And so this NIV doesn't mean New Inspired Version. It only means New International Version. And so friends, when we talk about inspiration, where the Holy Spirit guided the human writers, we're talking about the prophets who actually wrote the Old Testament, and we're talking about the apostles who actually wrote the New Testament. When they were writing it, they were inspired by the Holy Spirit. When it got translated, when it was recopied, the copies are no longer inspired, all right? The translations are no longer inspired. When we talk about inspiration, it's only the original writing of the apostles and the prophets. Now, there's a need to explain this, because some of you might feel right now, oh, Pastor, is that so? Then I don't need to spend time reading that Bible because it's not inspired anyway. You know, the translation that I have. Well, friends, you need to realize this. Number one, in the translation process, something is lost in the translation. Okay? It's hard to translate one word in Hebrew or in Greek and then make an exact replica in English. You know, some nuances are lost. You know, there's some cultural things attached to it. There's some, you know, there's some information in that language that cannot be transferred to another language. I mean, it's very clear. For example, the example that I use here is the word love. In Greek, they have four words for love. Only three are used in the New Testament. The fourth one, eros, is not used in the New Testament. But at least they have a specific word for love, all right? So in the New King James translation or version of John 21:15-17, and this is where the Lord Jesus Christ was talking to Peter after he already denied the Lord Jesus Christ three times, and the Lord Jesus Christ was like of, reinstalling him or reaffirming him to be the leader. The Lord Jesus Christ asked him this series of questions. Number one, Simon, son of Jonah, do you love me more than this? And Simon responded, yes, Lord, you know that I love you. And then Jesus Christ asked the second time, Simon, son of Jonah, do you love me? And Peter responded, yes, Lord, you know that I love you. And Jesus Christ the third time asked, Simon, son of Jonah, do you love me? And Peter responded, Lord, you know all things. You know that I love you. Now, all translations in English, that's the same translation. But in the original, that's not what it says, because in the original, the Lord Jesus Christ asked, Simon, son of Jonah, do you agape me more than this? And Peter responded, yes, Lord, you know that I phileo you. And Jesus Christ said, no, I'm not asking you to phileo, but do you agape me more than... He asked the second time, Simon, son of Jonah, do you agape me? And Peter said, yes, Lord, you know that I phileo you. And you know what happened? The Lord Jesus Christ condescended to Peter's state, and Peter said, and Jesus said, Simon, son of Jonah, do you phileo me? And Peter responded, Lord, you know all things, you know that I phileo you. Something happened here, and we need to understand the context here. Remember, before Peter denied the Lord Jesus Christ, he was so hambugiro, he was boasting, we will never leave you, we will die with you. And the Lord Jesus Christ said, you know what, before the cock crows twice, you will deny me three times. And exactly as the Lord Jesus Christ prophesied, Peter denied Jesus Christ that three times. So now when he was confronted, do you agape me? Do you unconditionally love me? Peter said, Lord, I already know myself. I know I cannot reach that level of agape. I'm here, I phileo you. But Peter, I want you to agape me. Lord, I'm sorry, I already know myself. I'm just up to phileo you, Lord. And the Lord Jesus Christ said, okay, Peter, do you phileo me? And Peter said, Lord, you know all things, you know that I phileo you. You see, the agape, unconditional love of God is not present in the human heart. Romans chapter 5 verse 5 says, and God's agape love is poured into our hearts through the Holy Spirit whom God has given us. So that means when you become born again, when we become Christians, the Holy Spirit indwells us, and the Holy Spirit comes with it is the agape love of God. That means we now have a reservoir of God's unconditional love. And as Christians, you can now love the unlovable. You can now forgive the unforgivable. You can now touch the untouchable. Now, that's what makes it different. That's what makes it different for us today. All right? We still go through the same problems people are undergoing. People have cancer. We can still have cancer. You know, our spouses may betray us the same way spouses outside would betray their spouses. But we now have the ability to forgive. We have the ability to love even the unlovable. And that's what makes us different. All right? So, again, something is lost in the translation. But in the science of translation, you know, they have three ways to translate. One is the formal equivalence, which is the word for word. They try as much as possible to, you know, the arrangement in the sentence as much as possible to be consistent with the way it was written in Hebrew or the way it's written in Greek. But obviously, you cannot do that, you know, for it to be plain English. And so they try to do dynamic equivalence, and that is thought for thought. They try to get the main idea first, and then they try to translate it into English. And then, of course, you have the paraphrase, the loose translation, like Philip's Living Bible and the Message. So for word for word, you have there the King James Version. Of course, that's the 1611 King James Version. Now, you don't have to use that anymore. You can use the New King James just to get rid of the archaic words. You know, yung bigat, sobrang bigat na. So, you know, you can use the New King James Version. You have the Revised Standard Version, the New Revised Standard Version. And then, of course, for me, the best word for word would be the New American Standard Bible. Now, the NIV is somewhere in between word for word and thought for thought. Somewhere in between. And then you have the thought for thought. You have the Good News Bible, the New English Bible, and of course, one of the latest translations that we have, the New Living Translation. The New Living Translation. And then, of course, we have the paraphrase translations right there. The Phillips Living Bible and the Message. Now, the reason why we discourage people from actually using a loose translation, the paraphrase translation, it's because for serious Bible study, I mean, you can read that for devotional reading, but for serious Bible study, here's the reason. Let me just pull out my file here. For example, in Psalm 119, 105, here's what it says in the NIV. It says here, your word is a lamp to my feet and a light for my path. Now, what they'll do in a paraphrase translation is try to change, you know, some of the words to adjust to the culture that we have today. Like nobody, not so many people are familiar with lamps. And so they change that in the Living Bible. Your words are a flashlight to light the path. And so again, if you change it to flashlight, you know, the imagery has changed. Now you have to think of the, ano kaya battery niyan? You know, what's the battery there? You know that some of the meaningful details are lost or added. And then in Acts 8:20, in the New International Version, it says here, Peter was so angry with Simon because he wanted to buy the Holy Spirit. He said, may your money perish with you. But then, in the translation of Philip's, to hell with you and your money. So medyo parang hindi magandang translation. And so that's the reason why we discourage people from using a paraphrase for serious Bible study. But again, as I've said, no problem with using it for devotional reading. And then, here's one thing that we need to realize, that the original writing in Greek changed, actually. The original writing, they write the words, all capitalized letters in Greek, and then all the words are connected. The original writing in Greek is called Ancial manuscripts. These are the actual letters, are all capitalized letters, and they're all connected. That means, as you read, you are the one to divide, actually, the words as you read. Now, it's not easy, isn't it? Because all the words are connected. For example, that's the Codex Sinaiticus, the 4th century. You can see that. It's all right there. So, all capitalized letters, and you have to divide. And that's why Paul said in 2 Timothy 2:15, be diligent in to present yourself approved to God, a worker who does not need to be ashamed, rightly dividing the word of truth. Because when they were reading it, they are actually to divide the words as they read. Because is it possible to divide it wrongly? You know, that's possible, isn't it? For example, that's the Ancial manuscript. For example, try to divide that. That's just in English, all right? Try to divide that. Try to read. Okay? Now, that's just in English, so we know that this is the beginning of the gospel of Jesus. Chi is Christ, Jesus Christ. You know, ink is so expensive, paper is expensive. So if they can contract a word, they'll contract it. Christ, they don't write the word Christ, they just put X. Chi. So that's already Christ, they know that. And so the Son of God. Now that's just in English. Now is it possible to have a different meaning when you divide it wrongly? For example, this, how do you divide that? So you can say, God is nowhere, or God is now here. Definitely the meaning would change. So we need to rightly divide the word of truth. All right? Another example here. This one, try to divide this for me, please. The way you divide it will change depending on your orientation. You know, your bias would dictate the way you divide this. For the male chauvinist or the feminist, let's start with the feminist. The feminist would divide it this way. The feminist would say, woman, without her, man is savage. That's the feminist, the way a feminist would divide that. But a male chauvinist would divide it differently. He would say, woman, without her, man is savage. And so that the meaning has already changed. Now, how about if the right division should have been woman without Herman is savage. And so again, that's what people were doing the translation. They need to be careful, especially when they're dealing with the ancient text where the words are connected and all capitalized. You know, you start from the right going to the left. And so, said is there, and then the therefore is right there, and you have to rearrange the words, and that is Jesus, just the Jesus, just to contract the letter, Jesus, and then Christ. And so again, it's not easy translating this. But then later on, several years later, they devised another way of writing, no longer capitalized letters, small letters, and now they divided the words. So it will be easier to read, easier to copy. And so this is now called the minuscule manuscripts. This was later on. And so with the minuscule manuscripts, the autograph, these are the only inspired version. That's the original writing of the apostles. So you have four families. You have copies made available to the Western churches. You have families made available to the Byzantine churches, the ones in Asia Minor right there. And then you have copies made available to the Caesarian churches in Palestine. And then you have copies made available to the Alexandrian, that's the Alexandrian family of manuscripts, to Northern Africa. So there are four families of manuscripts, you know, when they were copying it and recopying it. And so, but the only inspired version is the autograph. But friends, here's the problem with the Byzantine and the Alexandrian. With the Byzantine, you have the minuscule manuscripts. All right? Minuscule meaning these are the later writing, later version, the writing of the letters. The Alexandrian, you have the uncial. This is the old style of writing. So if you found two manuscripts, one uncial, one minuscule, which one is older? The uncial would be older because that's the way they wrote it in the several years before the minuscule. But then the Byzantine manuscripts, or the uncial, we have 306 manuscripts available for us today, while the Byzantine, we have 2,000, almost 3,000 copies. And so this became the difference between the King James Version. The King James Version are all Byzantine manuscripts, but then the NIV, you have these two put together, the minuscule and the uncial manuscripts. So what we have here is they have about 25 early manuscripts to start with in doing the Textus Receptus. The Textus Receptus, of course, became the basis for the 1611 King James Version, King James Version 2, and then the New King James Version. So the difference in timeline here, 100 is the close of the New Testament book, and then 1611 was when we had the translation of the King James Version. Their manuscripts dates back to 835 AD, and it's all minuscule. That's the oldest manuscript that they have, 835 AD, okay, for the King James Version of 1611. Now, what happened in 1859, they discovered uncial manuscripts that dates back to 340 AD. This was already 200 years later after the printing of the King James Version. 200 years later, they found older manuscripts, older than minuscule, 340 AD uncial manuscripts. Now, here's the problem. The uncial and the minuscule, there are differences in the writings. And so that's the main struggle there. Where do we put more authority, the older ones or the ones that we have more manuscripts to refer to, which is the minuscule? Okay, now, one of the reasons why we have different translations, for example, the New King James Version, New Testament was completed in 1979, the Old Testament in 1982, 130 translators, formal equivalence meaning word for word, but their target audience, the English, those who can understand, what's the word there? Proficiency in English would be second year college, okay? So they can understand English, the second year level college. But then they designed the NASB, the New American Standard Bible, completed in 1971 with 58 translators, formal equivalence, again, word for word, but their target audience are the fourth-year high school English. You know, their understanding of English, fourth-year high school. And then the NIV, 1978, when they completed this, 110 translators between the formal and dynamic, but the target audience is first-year high school. So if you're only understanding, your understanding of English only first year high school, then NIV would be the best translation to read. And then the NLT, of course, 1996, 90 translators, dynamic equivalence, thought for thought, but their target audience is grade 6. Comprehension, that's the word I was looking for. Their comprehension of English is just for grade 6. And so friends, that's one reason why you have different translations. The target audience is different, all right? And so the comprehension level of the readers is what they were concerned about. Okay, so that's what we have there, the translations. Again, when you talk about inspired, only the Old Testament prophets and then the New Testament apostles, when they wrote that, that's what's inspired. But friends, we need to realize this, that the oldest Old Testament text that we have before 1947 is the Aleppo Codex, and this dates back to 900 AD. All right, 900 AD. So that's the oldest Old Testament manuscript that we have before 1947. Something happened in 1947. The Dead Sea Scrolls were discovered, about 800 manuscripts, and you know what? They date back to 2nd century BC. Wow! Can you imagine that 2nd century BC? The oldest Old Testament that we have is 900 AD. In 1947, they discovered manuscripts 200 BC. How many years the difference? 200 BC to 900 AD? You don't just minus 900 minus 200. 200, you have to go to zero first. And then from zero to 900, that's about 1,100 years difference. And so friends, from this data alone, you can see that if there are errors in the copying, all right? If there are errors in the copying, you can see that the errors will multiply after 1,100 years when you have the 900 AD, comparing it with the 200 BC. But then here's the story of the Dead Sea Scrolls, 800 manuscripts. They were discovered in these caves. You know, when we went to Israel, we saw these caves from a distance. Of course, we were not allowed to get near that. But found in caves by a Bedouin shepherd. You know, this Bedouin shepherd was looking for his, mountain goats. And so he was looking to these caves if the goat was there. And 11 caves near the Qumran settlement, he was this. Qumran area is the northern part of the Dead Sea. Jerusalem is right here. So that's the northern area of the Dead Sea. And so the boy was standing right here and then throwing rocks into the cave just to scare the goat away, you know, for the goat to come out, to throw rocks. But then when he threw rocks, instead of a goat coming out, he heard cracks of pottery. You know, when the rock hit inside, there were pots inside that broke. And so these pots, when they were opened up, you know, these jars, when they were opened up, inside, miraculously preserved were the scrolls of the Old Testament scrolls. And so you have there the scrolls, most of them, of course, almost all the Old Testament books are there. And so these are the oldest of the Old Testament. They are more than 1,000 years older than any known Hebrew text, because our oldest is 900 AD only. This one is already 200 BC. And then they include sections or fragments from all the Old Testament books except the book of Esther. The book of Esther was the last book to be accepted as a part of the canon of the Old Testament. And the reason they say is because you don't find God in the book of Esther. And you know, the Jews, they're very meticulous when they are copying. You know, the scribes, when they copy, whenever they come across the name of God, they would ceremonially wash themselves. Maliligo muna before they write the word God, Elohim, no? Susulat nila. Can you imagine? Genesis 1:1, in the beginning, God, Elohim, created the heavens and the earth. Ligo muna yan bago isulat yung God. And then verse 2, nandun na naman yung God, ligo na naman. In the first 10 verses, you have 10 gods there, 10 times mentioned. Limang ligo, sampung ligo, 10 gods right there in those verses. While in the book of Esther, walang ligo-ligo, walang God eh. So they say, hindi inspired ito. Hindi inspired ito, walang God. Again, of course, during that time, they were trying to hide that identity of God. But we know that the book of Esther is, of course, inspired. And then their agreement with modern biblical texts confirms the remarkable accuracy of Jewish scribes. You know, they looked at the book of Isaiah. It's one complete there in the this ancient manuscript, in these Qumran manuscripts. They counted all the words, and then they compared the words to the 900 AD. All right? 200 BC ito, they compared it with the 900 AD, the Aleppo Codex. Again, 1,100 years yan. If there are errors and errors in the copying, friends, it will come out loud and clear in the 900 AD. But here's what happened. When they compared the 200 BC Isaiah scroll with the 900 AD Aleppo Codex, they found out only 3 words differ in spelling from modern Hebrew text. Wow! Now, friends, that gives you ample confidence that even though the inspiration is just the writing of the prophets, but when they were copying it, they know that this is scriptures, this is God's word. They dedicated their whole life just copying it so that you will have in your hand a copy of the words of God. And so friends, when you open your Bible, you can have confidence that these are the words of God. Amen. Amen. Now, that's the Old Testament. The New Testament is a different story. You know, in the New Testament, we don't have scribes. In the Old Testament, they have scribes. They really make that as their career. You know, just copying scriptures. In the New Testament, you know, we're at church and they receive a letter there from the apostle. Uy, ipadala mo si Jose. Marunong ka naman magbasa ng Greek, ano? Marunong ka magkopyahin mo yun para may kopya yung simbahan natin. You know, they can just send anybody just to have a copy of their own for their church. And remember, at that time, they don't have eyeglasses. And so there would be changes here. But here's the story of the New Testament. In the New Testament, why we have confidence in the New Testament, it's this. First of all, you have the autographs. Remember the autographs? That's the original writing of the apostles. That's what we call inspired. All right. Now, they were recopied, and the paper they used was the papyrus paper. It was brittle. After some time, it would disintegrate. And obviously, because of the passage of time, we only have 99 fragments of these copies of the New Testament. But then, later on, they were able to use parchments. These are the skin of the animal. This would be more durable than the papyrus. And now we have 306 copies of these parchments. They are all ancial. Ano ibig sabihin ng ancial? All capitalized letters, and they're all connected. That's the way it was written in the original. And then, these parchments, it was later on recopied, but this time using minuscule, small letters, and separated the words now. We have about 2,856 manuscripts in minuscule. And then, we have lectionaries. The lectionaries, because churches, they do not have Bibles, you know, the whole copy of the Bible. They would just choose passages for Sunday reading. Okay, so they would have lectionaries for the Sunday reading. And we have about 2,403 copies of these lectionaries, different passages of the Bible for their Sunday service. And then you have the Latin Vulgate. We have about 8,000 to 10,000 copies of the Latin Vulgate, the translation, Latin translation from the Greek. And then you have the other translations, the other languages, Ethiopic, Slavic, Armenian, and then about 8,000 copies of those. And then you have here the early quotations in the letters of early church fathers. You know, the early church fathers, they would write letters to different bishops, different people, and they would quote scripture in these letters. We have about 36,389 copies of these quotations from the different early church fathers. Let me show you here the copies of the early church fathers. So you have here the writer. If they quote from the gospel, it's here, Book of Acts, Pauline, General, Revelation, and then that's the total. So here you have Justin Martyr. He wrote a letter. He quoted the gospels 268 times, the Book of Acts 10 times, the Pauline epistles 43 times, General epistles 6 times, Book of Revelation 3 times, and then a total of 330. These early church fathers, you put them all together, 36,289 quotations. Friends, listen to this. Even if we've lost the whole New Testament, you can reconstruct the New Testament from these quotations from these early church fathers. 36,289 quotations from all the books in the Bible, Gospel, Acts, Paul in general, and then the Book of Revelation. So those are the totals there that you have of the quotations that they have. So friends, put them all together. What we have now, a massive number of documents to reconstruct the New Testament. Even though we don't have that 60,000 documents, even though we don't have the autographs, I can assure you, with the 60,000 manuscripts that we have, you can be 99.5 accurate of the translation that we have in the New Testament today. And so friends, we have confidence. We have confidence. Even though there are changes, that's true. There are some, you know, different errors there that has been passed on from one document to another. But friends, there's no variant. The variants are the differences. There's no variant that can change a major doctrine in the Christian faith. There's no variant that can change the major doctrine. All right? So that's the Old Testament. That's the New Testament. And so, again, just give you an example here. When you look at the Gospel of Mark towards the last chapter, it says there's a footnote in your Mark 16. You see that in your Bibles? Mark 16, 9 to 20. You can look at your Bible so that you know how to interpret these notations, this footnote. It says there in Mark 16, 9 to 20, the earliest manuscripts and some other ancient witnesses do not have Mark 16, 9 to 20. So what does that mean? That means, these friends, at the close, 100 AD, New Testament completed already, and then 300 AD, 600 AD, this is when you have the ancient manuscripts. This is the dates of the ancient manuscripts that we have, about 306 manuscripts that we have. Later on, they devise a new way of writing, starting with 800 AD, we have the minuscule manuscripts, the small letters, and then divided words. So what this means, the earliest manuscripts and some other ancient witnesses do not have Mark 16, 19 to 20. That means, friends, in the ancient manuscripts, they didn't find Mark 16, 9 to 20. But this passage is found in the minuscule manuscripts. So that's the debate, whether it was just added later on. We really do not know if it's part of the original. And so what that means, friends, is you do not make a doctrine out of an obscure passage. Because that passage is where it says, if you get bitten by a snake, you will get healed. And so there were these two pastors to prove that they are the real prophet of God. They used Mark 16, 9 to 20 as a test. Who is the real prophet of God? They had themselves beaten by a snake. These two pastors. Because it says that even if you're beaten with a snake, you will not die. And praise God, they both died. And so, joking aside, but that's a real news that came out in the United States, all right? So again, we don't base our doctrine on what we call this? Obscure passages, all right? So that's what it means. And then, number three now, plenary verbal inspiration does not allow for any false teaching, but it does on occasion record the lie of someone. What does that mean? Friends, listen to this very carefully because I don't want to be misquoted here. Not everything here in this book are the words of God. Some of the words here are the words of Satan. Did you get that? So this doesn't contain all the words of God. Some of it contains the words of Satan. Some the words of men. Give me an example of the words of Satan that are accurately written in this book. The temptation of the Lord Jesus Christ, okay? Turn these stones into bread. What else? Words of Satan, accurately recorded. Temptation of Eve, okay? Genesis chapter 3. How about men? Just the words of men. Not the words of God, but words of men accurately recorded here. Job and his three friends. You know, when you're reading Job, you need to be careful because they are not all words of God. Some of them are the words of men. But they're accurately recorded in the book of Job. But you don't get wisdom from that. You don't get guidance from because those are the words of men. They were later rebuked by God at the end of the story. So that's what it means. Does not allow for any false teaching, but it does on occasion record the lie of someone. And then the second half of number three, it says there, as one reads the Bible, he must carefully distinguish between what God records and what he sanctions. What does that mean? Between what God records and what he sanctions. Friends, listen to this. Just because it is recorded by God doesn't mean it is sanctioned by God. All right? Just because Solomon had how many wives? 700 wives and 300 concubines. 1,000. Women all in all. How many days in 1 year? 365, 1,000. Wow. Can you memorize 1,000 names? No. I'm sure there were nights when Solomon would say, "Musa kaya tingalan ni mo dai?" I know you won't memorize 1,000. What's your name again? But you know what? He's so wise. He printed a wedding anniversary card. And in this card, he wrote down, "You are 1 in 1,000. All right. So very accurate. So we must carefully distinguish between what God records and what he sanctions. You know, we may be laughing at this, but I can tell you a true story. I was just in the Middle East last March, and I won't tell you which city, but here's the problem. There was a pastor, the members found out that he's living with another woman. His wife is back in the Philippines. And you know, when they confronted the pastor who was living with this other woman, the pastor said, you know what, this is part of God's will. Because if God did not allow David to have an affair with Bathsheba, we won't have Solomon today. Can you imagine that kind of interpretation? Wow. And so friends, just because it's recorded doesn't mean it is sanctioned by God. So we need to be clear about that. And then number four, plenary verbal inspiration does not permit any historical, scientific, or prophetical error whatsoever. While it is admitted that the Bible is not a textbook on science, it is nevertheless held that every scientific statement in the Scriptures is absolutely true. So that's where we write down the word inerrancy, without error. Does not permit any historical, scientific, or prophetical error whatsoever. Now we know that many seminaries today, professors today, you know, they would tell us that the Bible contains lots of errors, scientific errors. Here are actual words of professors from seminaries. One professor said, the story of Adam and Eve's fall in the garden is not a historical account. You know, it's just a story. You know, it's just a, you know, the way we use fairy tale just to teach about good and evil. Another professor said, the story of Jonah is a parabolic satire against self-righteousness of the Jews. That means it's only a parable. It's not a historical account. And then he said, to read it as a factual or historical account raises endless questions. You know, how did Jonah come out alive after 3 days and three nights, you know, in the belly of a big fish? Nobody comes alive after 3 days and three nights in the big fish. So it will raise endless questions. And then another professor said, one must not look for scientific facts or historical accounts of the beginnings of the world and of the human race in Genesis. Aha. So that means if you want to find out where we came from, don't read the book of Genesis, because in Genesis, you were created by God. You read science. And from the science point of view, where did you come from? From the monkeys. Friends, to say that we came from the monkeys is a great insult. It's a great insult to the monkeys. Why? Because monkeys do not abort their children, only humans do. You know, the abortion rate in America right now is 4,300 babies a day. 4,300 babies a day in America alone, not including Canada. But can you imagine in China with a one-child policy? Of course, they're trying to ease that now. But can you imagine for so many years they have a one-child policy? How many abortions are happening? I mean, that monkeys can speak, no, you did not come from us. That's a great insult. And so friends, what we have here is what is considered today limited inerrancy. And limited inerrancy means that God gave us a functionally true Bible, but it has three things. It has historical data, it has scientific data, and it has a redemptive data. Of the three things, when it is just limited inerrancy, only the redemptive data is without error. But the historical data in the Bible, it has errors. The scientific data in the Bible, it has errors. Only the redemptive data is without error. That's what you call limited inerrancy. Well, friends, we don't believe that. You don't go to the Bible and choose, oh, this is not inspired, oh, this is not inspired, this is not true, this is not true, only this is true. We don't go to the Bible that way. We accept it as the Word of God. And that's how we bless people. That's how we preach about the Bible. But here, you have the full inerrancy, and in a full inerrancy, we believe that God gave us a verbally, fully inspired Bible wherein all the data that you find there, historical, scientific, redemptive data, they are without errors in all matters. Without errors in all matters. That's full inerrancy. And here in the Apollos Project, that's what we want to inculcate in the minds of pastors. It will be very hard to preach from the Bible where you have doubts if this is right or wrong, if this can be trusted or not. You know, it's so different when you begin to preach the Bible and you know it is God's Word. But friends, consider the historical accuracy of the Bible. Again, before the break, we'll just take two of these. But the historical accuracy of the Bible, the Lord Jesus Christ wholeheartedly believed in the following. He believed in the Genesis account of creation. I mean, he talked about it. He believed in Adam and Eve. It's a historical account. He talked about the historicity of Noah and the flood. We know it's true. Jesus Christ believed it. You know, my faith is simple. If Jesus Christ believes it, I believe it as well. All right? And then the Lord Jesus Christ talked about the historicity of the account of Sodom and Gomorrah. He talked about the historicity of Lot and his wife. He talked about the historicity of the manna from heaven. He talked about the historicity of the account of Jonah and the whale. In fact, when he talked about this, he used it as a historical reference to his own death and burial. Jesus Christ said, listen to the words. He said, just like Jonah, I'll stay 3 days and three nights in the tomb. Remember that? That means he used the Jonah story as a historical reference. Now, the difference is this. If Jesus Christ was saying, just like Jonah, I'll stay 3 days and three nights in the tomb, was Jesus Christ alive or dead inside the tomb? He was dead. That means, to be consistent, Jonah was also dead 3 days and three nights in the belly of the big fish, but God resuscitated him back to life after 3 days and three nights, just like the Lord Jesus Christ, after 3 days and three nights, he was resurrected back to life. All right? That would be more consistent. Now, that's just me. You don't have to believe that. Because some people would say, but Pastor Roy, in the book of Jonah, Jonah was talking about his experience inside the belly. That's true. Because the brain still, you know, the spirit is still there. Have you heard of the clinically dead people? They died for just a few minutes and then their spirits would float and they would describe what was happening in the operating room. They can describe what's happening even after they die. All right? And so I believe that's what Jonah was saying. Now, again, as I've said, that's just me. You don't have to believe that. But in our Sunday school, of course, we teach that Jonah was alive all throughout the time that he was in the belly of the big fish. But again, that's just a position. But friends, here's the thing. If an Old Testament professor says that Jonah is just a parable, and Jesus believes that Jonah is historical account, not just a parable, I'd rather put my faith in Jesus than put my faith in an Old Testament PhD professor. Amen? That's the way my mind would work. Because, you know, sometimes PhD, it means permanent head damage. You know? Sometimes that's what happens with a PhD. Sometimes with the THD. THD means THD, temporary head damage, you know? But you see, my doctorate is just D-min. D-min means damage minimal. All right. And so, pwede pa, pwede pa. Just minimal damage. All right. Now, about the Old Testament. Now, here's a professor with a PhD, considered to be without equal. He is a professor, a scholar without peer. Did you get the word? Without peer. Not fear, but peer. P-E-E-R. Ano ibig sabihin no without peer? Walang kapantay, walang kasama, nag-iisa, bukod tangi. You know, na Old Testament professor or doctor, he said, for 45 years continuously, since he left college, he devoted himself to the one great study of the Old Testament in all its languages, all its archaeology, all its translations, and as far as possible in everything bearing upon its text in history. And here's his conclusion. After 45 years, he said, the result of my 45 years of study of the Bible has led me all the time to a firmer faith that in the Old Testament, we have a true historical account of the history of the Israelite people. Now, that guy has a PhD, but not permanent head damage, all right? So, for example, the Red Sea crossing. Now, one of the most dramatic records of divine intervention in history is the account of the Hebrews' exodus from Egypt. And traditionally, we have been teaching or we've been telling people that the crossing happened right here. But, and then of course we say that traditionally Mount Sinai is here. So right now, if you have a tour guide, this is still the Sinai that will bring you for you to see. But now we know that the crossing actually happened here. This is the Gulf of Aqaba. And this is Jebel Elos. This is Mount Sinai. This is already inside Saudi Arabia. And so they crossed right here and then they went up, going here to Moab and then going to the Promised Land. And the reason why we believe this is because of these pillars that were discovered, Solomon's memorial pillars. Ron Wyatt first visited Nueva. Nueva Beach is right here. This is the Saudi coastline. Nueva Beach is here. In 1978, he found a Phoenician-style column lying in the water. Unfortunately, the inscriptions had been eroded away. Hence, the column's importance was not understood until 1984, when a second granite column was found on the Saudi coastline opposite, this one here, identical to the first, except on this one, the inscription was still intact. And so that's the column that they found. They took the picture right there. Ron Wyatt found two pillars King Solomon put on both beaches to commemorate the Red Sea crossing. And then written in Phoenician letters, archaic Hebrew, it contained the words Mizraim, which is the old name for Egypt, Solomon, Edom, Death, Pharaoh, Moses, and Yahweh, indicating that King Solomon had set up these columns as a memorial to the miracle of the crossing of the sea. And so again, the more they dig, you know, archaeologists, the more we find out that the Bible is true. But then they did more than that discovery. Checking sonar depth measurements, Wyatt discovered an underwater land bridge exactly between Nueva Beach and the Saudi side. All right? And then depth sounding expeditions have revealed a smooth, gentle slope descending from Nueva out into the Gulf. This shows up almost like a pathway on depth recording equipment, confirming its biblical description, a way in the sea and a path in the mighty waters. And so Ron Wyatt decided to go scuba diving and look underwater there. Guess what he discovered? And so this is the spot where he discovered this that area right there. You see that the chariot wheels found at the bottom of the Red Sea, chariot wheel and axle covered with coral and upended. And then there's the gilded chariot wheel, mute witnesses to the miracle, found with a metal detector, a coral-encrusted chariot wheel filmed off the Saudi coastline. The hope for future expeditions is to explore the deeper waters with remote cameras or mini-subs. So they also found the chariot bodies as well as human and horse bones. And then, of course, King David, you know, it was questioned for so long a time that King David, there wasn't really a monarchy by David. But in 1993, they found this lab. And finally, it put to rest that there was a Davidic dynasty, because it says right there. Do you see that? I can read it. It says the house of David. You see? Right there. The house of David was discovered in northern Israel dating from the 9th century BC. This confirms both the reign of David and a Davidic dynasty that followed him. One more, and then Sennacherib's campaign, 700 BC. This is the Taylor Prism. It's a clay, and then Sennacherib, the king of the Assyrians, recorded his exploits. And then in one of the recordings here, it says, "As to Hezekiah the Jew, he did not submit to my yoke. I lay siege to 46 of his strong cities, walled forts, and small villages, and conquered them." You know, he was nagyayabang. You know, he was boasting about this, bragging about, you know, how he conquered this Hezekiah the Jew. But you know what? If you read the Bible, you'll find here in 2 Kings 18:13, in the 14th year of King Hezekiah's reign, Sennacherib, king of Assyria, attacked all the fortified cities of Judah and captured them. Do you see that? The one-to-one correspondence. And again, you have there the history according to Sennacherib, and then the history in the Bible, they're one and the same. That's the Old Testament. How about the New Testament? Sir William Ramsay. Again, here's one guy who started as an unbeliever. He doesn't believe the Bible. But in order to research the Asia Minor, you know Asia Minor? Where is that found? In Turkey. Why was it called Asia Minor? Because the Asians who lived there were all minors at the time. Now, that's just to augment your understanding. Now, actually, we do not know why it's called Asia Minor. But that's Asia Minor right there. And here's what he did. In his zeal to study every available early document concerning ancient Asia Minor, he undertook an intensive research of the New Testament book of Acts and also the Gospel of Luke. He didn't believe the Bible, so this study was approached with much skepticism. In fact, he considered the book of Acts as highly imaginative and carefully colored account of primitive Christianity. Wala talagang very biased when he started this work. But you know what happened? After many years of intensive study, the absolute historical accuracy of Luke's writings, even in the most minute details, captured first his brain and then his heart. This scholar who began an unbeliever became a staunch defender of the Bible. He became a Christian. And one of those things that convinced him is what Luke wrote in Luke chapter 3, verse 1. It says here, when Pontius Pilate was governor of Judea, you know, for many years, they cannot find any Roman document, not a single Roman document that identifies Pontius Pilate as a governor of Judea. They cannot find that. Scholars dismiss this as this is just a creation of Bible writers, but no historical reference. But then, in 1961, they found this lab, dating back from the first century AD, and right there, can you see that? It says there, Pontius Pilate. Mababasa ko Pontius Pilate. Right there. You know? It says Pontius Pilate. But actually, what is written there is right there. It's Tiberium Pontius Pilate, prefect of Judea. This inscription is the only archaeological evidence of both Pilate's name and this title. Finally, laid to rest, there is a Pontius Pilate who ruled in Judea. And then, the ossuary of Caiaphas. Ossuary is a box, a bone box, where you put the bones of the deceased, including his family. And so in 1990, an ossuary was found in a Jewish cemetery near Jerusalem, dating from the first century AD. That's the ossuary box. You can see it's so ornate. You know that this belongs to a very important historical figure. But what astounded them were the words here, Yosef Bar Kapha, Joseph, son of Caiaphas. The inscription indicates the bones inside include those of Caiaphas, the high priest, who questioned Jesus. Friends, in 1990, they found the bones of the accuser. But up to today, they cannot find the bones of the accused. Why? Because Jesus Christ rose from the dead. Amen. So that's historical accuracy. But after the break, we will look into the scientific accuracy of the Bible. Now, this one will just blow your mind. It's just impossible that this is just human imagination and this is not divine revelation. And so here, after the break, we look into the scientific accuracy of the Bible. All right, let's take a break.